Welcome to another Magic TV Top 8. I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left. With me, as always, Luis Scott Vargas and Paul Chion. Today, we're going to do Top 8 7 drops. And by 7 drops, it's 7 mana creatures. Creatures only. Not planeswalkers.
Yeah. So Karn would be on the list otherwise.
Luis wanted to push so hard for this. But, I mean, the reason why we're doing 7 drops is because, as we all know, Luis just has an unnatural love for 7 drops.
I actually wanted to do top 7, but we'll do it.
Thank you so much. Wow. Thank you kindly. Coming in at number 8. But what I have to do this. Honorable mention, Phyrexian Colossus. I do think Phyrexian Colossus should be on this list.
It did get printed in 1995, so I understand why.
Obviously, I would champion. The card was awesome. It was played.
It was good in Tinker. I will give it that. I played with it.
And even before the Finkel version of Tinker, it was still people were still immediately tinkering out Phyrexian Colossus and getting in there for 8. So I am going
to
say...
A shout out to Phyrexian Colossus.
Still love you, buddy. All right. Number 8, Platinum Angel.
Yeah, Platinum Angel's seen play in a number of different decks. One among them is the Tinker decks,
of course,
once Mirrodin came out, because you could Tinker Platinum Angel and put Lightning Grease on it and lock them out.
Right.
Some Tooth and Nail decks. Tooth and Nail for it. It's just a cool card.
It is. And I mean, it does have that feel of like, hey, I can't lose. What are you going to do now?
It literally says it on the card.
Yeah.
You can't lose. I mean, it was the first, when the card was first printed, people were like, oh man, this card's like really insane.
How could you have this ability?
I remember a lot of Tooth and Nail decks was just like, Tooth and Nail for 2 Platinum Angels.
Or Platinum Angel Leona Nabunis.
That's what it was.
Right, right, yeah.
Platinum
so
Angels
to protect
the
angel.
Because the 5 toughness is just better.
Right,
so.
Right. So there you got Platts. Number 7, Avenger of Zendikar.
Avenger of Zendikar is featured in the deck that Paulo won Pro Tour San Juan with, where you just Lotus Code Route an Avenger of Zendikar, make a million tokens, and make all those tokens into 3/4s.
Mm-hmm.
And the card has seen a lot of play. For a 7 drop. I mean, 7 drops have a natural barrier to entry. It's that they cost 7. So,
well, that doesn't stop you.
Right. But it stops a lot of other people.
Right. Yeah. And I mean, the traditional world of 7 drop is game over. And Avengers Zendikar spells game over.
Especially if you could slow roll it to go Avenger, play a land. Mm-hmm. And then even if they kill the Avenger, you end up with a bunch of 1/2s.
Right. You're still getting value out of it.
It was played in the Malakut decks in Standard. I mean, overall,
it's seen a lot of play. Great for 7 drop. And can literally spell game over if left unchecked.
What doesn't literally spell? It sounds like a lot of them. You could arrange it on the...
Thank you, Luis.
In case you're wondering, Mashi.
Speaking of platinum comments.
Yeah.
Next up, number 6, another earlier card, Palancron.
Which was kind of a 7 drop, kind of a 0 drop.
Yeah, it came in for free, basically.
Kind of a negative 7 drop, because in the high tide decks, you'd high tide cast Palancron,
and then infinite
if
mana.
If you had 6 lands out, you'd have infinite mana.
I mean, well, Academy, for the week or 2 it was legal, it's just like... obscene untapping
completely broken anytime. They're more careful about it now, but anytime you can just like basically have these free spells with ways to like double your mana.
Well, bouncing him for cheap was just like, it was just unbelievable. Like generating infinite mana just like that was ridiculous.
I actually went off in a cube draft online with Sneak Attack Palancron, because there you only have 6 mana.
Or like Mirari's Wake, and you need to have like a bunch of lands in play.
Value Town, Palancron, overpowered. Even as a flyer, you could fly in there and win, but obviously more an engine for mana than anything else.
Protects itself, you know?
Just drop it and then just start bashing.
Yeah.
Number 5, a 7 drop, not necessarily utilized as much as a 7 drop. Number 5 was Eternal Dragon.
Yeah, where you, I mean, the natural play pattern is this. You cycle it on turn 2, and then eventually start bringing it back and keep cycling it. And once you've got enough lands, which for most people is not ever, you just cast it and attack them.
Yeah. I mean, it's just the ultimate, like, the grindiest card ever, right? Like, you almost always just plain cycle it, get it back. Like a few copies of it was usually played during Astral Slide.
Triggers Astral Slide.
Right.
Lightning Rift, Astral Slide.
Slide Rift. It was great.
I like how so far, like, 2 of the 7 drops is just like, you don't actually really cast it, you know, like, legitimately.
Well, 7 drops are like that, right? You know, you tooth it out.
Platinum Angel, you don't really cast it.
Yeah, you tooth out the
Platts. That's true.
So Avengers kind of the only one.
In Tron, you do cast it.
But moving up the list, number 4, Angel of Despair.
Yeah, where Solar Flare was the main way we played Angel, or it was our first tournament success for me. And then...
I think this should be higher up on the list. I might be a little bit biased here.
It is Vindicate on a flying angel body.
And our deck actually... we basically just cast it. I mean, sometimes you'd zombify it, but mostly
We played Solar Flare, where the idea was, you know, you could turn to compulsive research, discard Angel of Despair, then zombify it into play, and boom, You know, you just have
kill
but,
land.
Yeah, right, yeah, right, kill your land. LD 5/5. Yeah, but you know, it's just such a strong card, and a lot of times, I mean, we had like signets and stuff. We just ramp up and just cast
and
it.
And then also, like, it was a pretty key part of Hypergenesis. Like, mm-hmm, putting a bunch of angels is pretty good.
Getting there, blowing up.
It's a little out shined now by Ashen Rider, but Angel of the Spirit is still the original seven drop.
Yeah. And especially because, like, you know, nowadays everything's so much more streamlined. If you're gonna have a big threat, you just might as well just have it cost like a ton more, right? Like, the more expensive doesn't matter because it's all about just the power level. That's why you're playing Gristlebrands and Ashen Riders instead of something like an Angel of Despair.
Number three, Elesh V. Elesh Norn.
Elesh Norn, generally not cast also. Unburial Rites, very common. Right, puts Elesh Norn into play. That's
modern gifts.
Yeah, moderns, you just gifts for Unburial Rites. Elesh Norn, put it into play. And then
one way or another, she's going to come in and wrath you. The Grand Cenobite is pretty, pretty hefty and a great seven drop.
Can Pod even beat that?
It has trouble. Like, you can Shriek Mod. You can Shriek Mod and kind of come back.
Yeah,
but
it's tough. And if you can get it without being too low against Affinity, it's also just ridiculous.
Number two, Luis, you can tell us a lot about Regal Force.
Yeah, I mean, Regal Force, continuing with the theme, not really getting cast much.
Right.
Because in current Legacy Elves, you can natural order for it. Mm-hmm. Though, of course, in the deck that we played in Berlin, you would just cast it eventually.
Yeah, we actually cast it. We legitimately cast it. Mm-hmm. Although we cast cards that are no longer legitimate in modern.
Right.
Glimpse of Nature being a little too powerful.
But Regal Force, a beating when it does come down, is awesome. I'm sure you could say much, much more about that deck and that card, but going to number one, is this the only non-rare on this list?
Yeah, it's a common.
Yeah, everything's a mythic and a rare.
To be good at seven is really tough. And
this one costs like two.
Yeah,
or zero.
Number one, Mirror Enforcer.
Yeah.
And this guy, I mean, in standard.
I mean, he's just a Mirror Enforcer, but he really did get the job done.
You did the same thing with Mirror Battlesphere. Yeah, come on, we were looking at seven drops. Mirror Battlesphere was one of them.
It's a Mirror Battlesphere.
It's merely a Battlesphere. Yeah, exact same thing.
But we were not on camera for that, so I had to like. He had to
share the love with everyone else.
Well, yeah, you do have a tendency to recycle jokes, but Mirror Enforcer. You know, it's not seen any playing anymore because all the artifact lands were banned, but when they were legal, it was an absolute beating.
When you got to play
beating.
All Ancient Tombs, Mirror Enforcer got a lot better.
Yeah, exactly.
Zero mana, 4/4, pretty good.
Yeah.
I think the other honorable mention at number one is, of course, Hexblade Golem, which kind of inspired the
Hexblade Golem, you know, the reason why we did come up with the number one seven drop.
Yeah. There you have it, our top eight seven drops.
So top seven drops plus one.
Top eight seven drops. At eight, Platinum Angel. Seven, Avenger of Zendikar. Coming at number six, Palancron. Number five, Eternal Dragon. Then Angel of Despair, Elesh Norn, Regal Force. Rounding the whole thing out, Mirror Enforcer at number one, with honorable mentions to Hexblade Golem and Phyrexian Colossus.
Well, and Karn.
And Hexblade Golem.
And Hexblade Golem.
Yeah, once again.
Sure. Thanks for tuning in.